this various administrative duties at the center for helping us putting this together at very short notice, and I should also thank you for coming at this short notice. But we begin with this image, which was taken very, very far away in the emptiness of space. What you see here, I should probably ask you, do any of you recognize this picture? This is a classic picture in space sciences.
Pale blue dot.
This picture was taken 6 billion kilometers away by an instrument known as the Voyager satellite, which is the instrument, man-made instrument, which has traveled the furthest in space. In fact, right now, as I speak, it's about 19 billion kilometers away from Earth, out of the heliosphere, which is the sphere of influence of the Sun and the solar system. And the reason that this picture was taken was because of this man, Carl Sagan. So before the cameras of this satellite were switched off, Carl Sagan was a legendary astrophysicist and a science popularizer and also a great writer. Convinced NASA to turn back the cameras of Voyager and point it back from where its journey had begun. And this is the last picture that Voyager took. It's known as the pale blue dot. You don't see much in this image until I point out something to you. Right there. What is that? What? That is Earth. So this picture became iconic because it's a portrayal of our existence in the vast enormity of space and the vulnerability of this planet, which what we call home, and sort of formed the basis of a famous book that he wrote as well called The Pale Blue Dot. So I'll begin the story of the Earth, but before that we have to get certain things. We have to get to the birth of the universe, the birth of solar system, planets, and where we are all headed. So this talk is about life and death in the universe. So this is the constellation of Cassiopeia, which is a collection of stars in our local galaxy, which is the Milky Way galaxy. And if you look hard enough and you are imaginative, you might see this in the constellation of Cassiopeia. When you ask who is she, this is the queen of Ethiopia, whose name was Cassiopeia, whose name is given to this constellation. And I bring this up because I wanted to convey that the story of the universe is also intricately linked with our cultures, with the legends and stories that we write, with myths that we create, and it's part of our living existence in some ways. So let me tell you the story of Cassiopeia. So Cassiopeia was the queen of Ethiopia, married to Cepheus, the king, and she was very arrogant. She was very arrogant and she thought that she was the most beautiful woman in the universe, and she thought that her beauty was unparalleled and she was more beautiful than the sea goddess Juno, and she proclaimed it. And of course, this didn't please the sea god too much. The sea god was Poseidon in Greek mythology. So Poseidon got mighty pissed and cursed the kingdom of Ethiopia and sent the sea serpent Cetus to destroy the Ethiopian coast. So while Cetus was in the act of destroying the Ethiopian coast, the king of Ethiopia, Cepheus, and Queen Cassiopeia prayed to the gods and asked for forgiveness. And they advised the king and the queen to sacrifice their daughter, whose name was Andromeda, which is also, as you know, is the name of the local galaxy. What they did was, from the advice of these gods, they chained Andromeda and put her on the coast, the sea coast. And there on the coast, the sea serpent Cetus advanced on Andromeda. And it so happened that the Greek hero Perseus, who you might have heard of, was passing by in his horse, and he saw the sea serpent and he promptly came down and killed the sea serpent, saw Andromeda and fell in love and married her. Which is a nice end to the story, except that this of course didn't please the sea god Poseidon. So he cursed Cassiopeia, chained her into a seat and banished her to the constellation of stars, which is now known as Cassiopeia. So bring up the story with another reason. So Cassiopeia is also the local graveyard of stars, in the sense that this is fairly old constellation, and there are many stars which are in its death throes. And what you see here is Cassiopeia A, which is a supernova in the form of a supernova explosion, is exploding in the form of a supernova. And this is how very massive stars, much, much larger than the Sun, actually end. I'll get into details of how this happens in terms of the physics of it. But for the time being, let me just tell you that so while a huge massive star is dying, its outer parts are thrown away in a huge explosion, which is known as a supernova explosion. This is one of the largest and possibly the biggest explosions in the universe. And the amount of energy that comes out in a short while is equivalent to the energy that the Sun gives out in its entire lifetime of 10 billion years. So this outer shell is thrown out in this, you know, in this process of death of the star. And this creates ripples in space-time, which is known as gravitational waves. With Rajesh here works on, he's going to talk about gravitational waves. And it also creates shock waves, which passes through the local interstellar medium. And when it does this, it disturbs the interstellar gas and forms clumps, out of which new star stellar systems and planets are born. And this is important because in the death of stars also lies the renewal of new stellar and planetary systems where life can be born. But let me begin at the beginning. We talked about the death of stars, but let me go to the beginning of where it all began. And you might guess what is coming, right? In the beginning, there was a Big Bang. So the universe was, point in time, very tiny, very, very dense, and very, very hot. And in this initial phase, known as the inflationary phase, this extreme pressure resulted in an outward expansion of this very, very hot, dense plasma. And about 3,000 years into the life of the universe, electrons and protons started combining with neutrons to form neutral atoms. And about 1 billion years into the age lifetime of the universe, these neutral atoms started clumping together to form the first structures, known as protostars, out of which stars were born, eventually galaxies were born, and finally systems, solar systems, stellar systems like our own solar system originated from this. Okay, so let me see, I seem to have jumped ahead to the end to get that. Okay, so a little bit of a physics of what works when you're trying to put together matter to build the universe. It's not as simple as it sounds. So what you see here on the left is the hydrogen atom, where you have a simple electron and proton. But when you form higher mass elements, for example helium, you have to put together a proton into a nucleus where there is another proton already, right? So now this is problematic because you have to overcome what is known as the electrostatic repulsion of the Coulomb barrier. Right? Because you are bringing in one proton into a nucleus which already has protons in it. And you bring it close enough through this Coulomb barrier so that strong nuclear interactions, which are effective only at very short ranges, ranges of the nuclear scale, become important and can bind the nucleus together. So this process can happen only in extreme temperatures and pressure, which are possible in the universe. This is how you build from tiny subatomic particles into larger and larger masses. Now, where can we achieve such extreme temperatures and pressure? We can achieve such extreme temperatures and pressure to synthesize elements in the interior of stars. So, I'll give you a few examples here. For example, in the sun, in the core, center of the sun, temperature and pressure are extreme, where you can fuse hydrogen through fusion reactions, through a set of reactions to eventually produce helium. Okay. Once you have produced helium, what happens is 2 helium 4 nuclei can combine together to produce beryllium 8, which is fairly unstable, which exists for a very short period in time. And within this period, if it collides with another 4 helium nuclei, then you form a 12 carbon nuclei. And this is fairly tightly bound with a stable nuclei, and it's very difficult to synthesize this further into other elements unless you hit higher temperatures. This is also possible in stars which are more massive and in supernova explosions as well. What is important here is to realize that in this synthesis of elements, what you have achieved in the universe are the building blocks of life. You have hydrogen, now you have produced carbon, and you have produced oxygen. That is not enough. So, I talked about supernova, the death of stars. And the death of stars, I said, you have new life which is renewed. And this is important because supernova explosions allow the most extreme conditions in the universe where you can synthesize higher mass elements. And the way this goes is, let's say I have a nuclei which is AXZ, atomic mass A, atomic number Z. It combines the neutron to produce a higher atomic mass A plus 1 element. Now, this is of course unstable because this is too massive and undergoes beta decay. So in the process of beta decay, what happens is you lose an electron and element Y becomes Z eventually. So what you have achieved through this process is, starting from the element X, you produce an element Z which has both, which is stable and which has both higher mass as well as higher atomic number. So through this process, in supernova explosions, what you are doing is you are synthesizing higher and higher mass elements that you see eventually making up planets and making up plants and trees and human beings. Okay? This is important to realize. So most of you have perhaps obviously have seen the periodic table. What you did not know about the periodic table is this. Now look at where did the elements in the periodic table originally came from. This is where it came from. Hydrogen and helium came from the Big Bang. Subsequently, these lighter elements were all synthesized inside stars of various mass ranges, large stars. Much higher mass elements originated in supernova explosions. What is important again to point this out here is to realize that tiny little things which are very, very important for us. For example, you'd have a hard time living if you don't have a thyroid gland. Right? The iodine in the thyroid gland that you have eventually, far back in time, originated in a supernova explosion. So you carry, each of us carry a little bit of a star or a dying star inside of you. How does structure form in the universe? How do we build up larger and larger structures? How do we form stars? How do we form planets? So there are two competing forces, two very important and competing forces which interplay to produce structure in the universe. The first one is gravity, where you have a couple of masses. They like to attract each other and clump together. Okay. But if this is the only process, then this would continue ad infinitum and you would see everything clump together in one place. It's not what you observe, right? So the other competing force is pressure. This arises eventually because of, well, you know some amount of power of physics, of temperature and density. If I heat up a box of particles, I am imparting kinetic energy to these particles. So you know, their mean kinetic energy increases and collision between them increases the frequency of collisions, and therefore I have larger pressure. So the pressure is trying to pull out, rip apart the system, right? Because there's outward pressure. And gravity is trying to pull this together and coalesce them. So a fine balance between these two forces eventually will result in a still astrophysical object such as a star. Okay. Alright. Fine. So this is the large Magellanic Cloud, which is a nursery of stars in the sense that this is a star-forming region. What you see in this star, and I think this is a Hubble Space Telescope image, what you see here is this distribution of gases that you see in this sort of region here, interstellar gas. From gravitational instability in certain parts of this gas, what you have is matter clumping together, coming closer and closer. When this goes on, eventually the center, the pressure of this material that is outside becomes intense and the temperature also increases. There is high density, high pressure, high temperature. Eventually this attains conditions which are suitable for nuclear fusion. So they are more or less dynamically compared to a star. They're dynamically dead in some sense. Although there is of course a lot of geological processes that go on, but not in the sense of any astrophysical time scale. Okay. So this is how our solar system was born. The sun was born and planets formed out of a protostar and a disk that surrounded it. Okay. Once a star is born, it will leave for a certain amount of time. How long it leaves depends on the amount of nuclear fuel, for example, hydrogen, that it has. Take the example of a sun, which is burning hydrogen. When I use the term burning, I mean that it's, nuclear fusion reactions is destroying hydrogen and creating helium. So there is enough hydrogen to last for about 10 billion years. This is the prime time, so to speak, the active youth of a star like our sun. When in the interior, hydrogen is burning out to produce helium, there's enough temperature and pressure to hold a star together in a stable equilibrium, hydrostatic equilibrium. So, since I work on the sun, let me talk a little bit about some of the activity of the sun. So, this image was painted by Galileo. Galileo's early observations of the sun, where you see sunspots, dark structures in, on the surface of the sun. When you see through a modern telescope and zooming into a sunspot structure, you see this beautiful structure, which are actually very strongly magnetized. And most stars like the sun are dynamically active, and it does influence the environment in the system that it hosts, like the solar system. What are some of the activities? So some of the activities that the sunspots produce are intense solar storms, which spews out vast amounts of magnetized plasma into space, which impacts the environment and creates what is known as space weather, which impacts satellites, it impacts GPS navigation networks, electric power grids, many other technologies. And so this is something that we try to predict how active the sun is going to be, and eventually try to understand how the storms are produced and how they propagate through the solar system. So this is an image of a solar storm and disturbance propagating through the solar system, which is being created through interplanetary scintillation measurements at the Ooty radio telescope, which is situated in the south of India in Tamil Nadu. And it shows that the space around us is not quiescent, it is dynamic and it is controlled by an active star, which is not just sitting there. It is doing something to its environment. And I want to point out that this shows that we have a very fragile existence when you have an active star as your host. And the only reason that we have survived is because we have a magnetosphere. The magnetic fields that is created by the Earth's dynamo, which eventually produces the magnetosphere, helps protect us by making sure that this interplanetary storms from the sun does not enter the Earth's atmosphere. Okay, the sun will be active. But eventually, all this activity will die when it runs out of hydrogen fuel. So in the core, there is a certain finite amount of hydrogen. When this runs out in about 5.5 billion years, nuclear reactions that support this high temperature and pressure is no longer going to happen, same rate, and the system is going to start collapsing. Yes, because gravity is then going to win. So this is the beginning or the death of the solar system and a sun-like star. So what happens is this. So the inner core of the star, where the nuclear reactions are going on, will start collapsing. Okay, and release gravitational energy which will heat up the outer shell of the sun, and the hydrogen that is there in the outer shell, where the temperature was not large enough to have nuclear reactions, will now get hotter because of this release of gravitational energy from the collapsing core. The outer shell gets so hot that nuclear reaction starts in the outer shell. Onward you had the helium. This hits up the outer shell, which now expands. It expands massively, creating what is known as red giant. The sun will become a red giant. And it's just a comparison, the sun now, whose diameter is right now about 0.01 astronomical unit, which is about 11 meters. The red giant's diameter will be 2 astronomical units. So when this happens, the expanding red giant will eat up, literally eat up the inner planets, starting with one by one, Earth will also go image. Finally, what will happen is this, the outer shell expands and moves out, the inner shell is contracting, right, gravitationally contracting, so it's heating up as well as it's contracting. And the temperature gets so hot that the next set of reactions, which I pointed out, helium getting converted to carbon will start in the core of this collapsing inner core of the sun. So eventually, most of the helium will then be converted to carbon, and what will be left is a very small, compact object, the same size as the Earth, the same size as the Earth, from the massive scale of the sun, the same size as the Earth, whose mass is almost half the sun. So very, very dense, but very, very compact object, which is known as the white dwarf. You see that in the center of this image. That small white dot there is a white dwarf, which is giving off some radiation because it is hot. And this radiation lights up the outer shell in this beautiful cosmic spectacle, which is known as a planetary nebula. So, this is how our solar system will end in a very beautiful fashion, which is not necessarily something that is good for us. So, what happens to humanity and life as you know it when this happens? So, I do not have an answer to that, but if you look at how fast our science and technological advances have progressed. We are right now thinking of colonizing Mars. The instrument that has been made by man has traveled much further away from the solar system. It is gone from the solar system. It's traveling out somewhere. We don't know what's happening to it. And what I forgot to mention about Voyager is also something very interesting. Voyager is carrying an audiovisual disc. This audiovisual disc has encyclopedia of scientific information in it. It has pictures of human beings and animals. It has recordings of human voices. It has a recording of the sound of the sea waves. So it's a message from Earth, just in case there is extraterrestrial life somewhere, which discovers Voyager transiting through the system and can decipher this information, figure out that life exists elsewhere on Earth. Okay, so we don't really know what's going to happen to humanity, but the hope is that we should be able to have technological advance to allow us to leave the solar system and colonize other solar-like systems which are hosted by other stars where life as we know it is possible. This almost takes one to the realm of science fiction, and thus I will show this image. How many of you recognize this image? Raise your hands. Just a few. Goa Star Wars. This is Luke Skywalker in Star Wars 4, A New Hope. From his home planet, a little bit of homework for you to figure out what his home planet is. He's looking at a stellar system, which is a binary star. So he is, you know, two stars. So they see two sunrises and two sunsets. And it's entirely possible that someday we may colonize a system such as this, which is in the realm of science fiction. And I sure hope that this is something that is a distinct possibility in the future, where some future form of life, not necessarily as we know it, but some form of life can look back into the vast emptiness of space, perhaps at a white dwarf, and think that that's where we came from. So railway stations are where journeys begin and end, are a good source of stories. So let me end this story at the Union Station in Washington, D.C. And let me end this story with the person I began this story with, Carl Sagan. The story goes that, which is a real story. Carl Sagan was once traveling to Washington, D.C. for a meeting with some of his colleagues. And he got down at the station with a suitcase. And he got down from the train, a porter. So a porter is a coolie, right? What we call in India coolies. Those men in red coats, inconsequential men. We think of them as inconsequential, who help you carry your luggage. This porter came to help him, took his suitcase, and carried it for him to a taxi which was waiting outside, and helped him get into the car. So when Carl Sagan took out his purse to pay this porter for his services, the porter politely refused and said, "You gave me the universe." So I want to end with that, and I want to point out the universe here, of course, is proverbial, in the sense that one has to see it in perspective. And for me, the universe could be the sun that I study. For somebody, such as a particle physicist or chemist, it could be tiny atoms and molecules. For others, as biologists, it could be the walk of ants or the swing of bacteria. The point is that there is a universe out there. And the message I want to send is, it's exciting things. And explore, discover, and hopefully when you do this, have some fun. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such an enlightening talk. Now I move on to the audience, and if someone wants to ask Dr. Nandi any question, feel free to ask him. Anyone? Sir?
Yes.
Can sun turn into a black hole?
No. So one has to, so it depends on the initial mass with which a star is born. For a black hole, you need a star which is much, 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 much more massive than the sun. So it depends. For example, somewhat more massive stars in the sun can turn into neutron stars, pulsars. Some which are much more massive can even turn into. Sun will not turn. It will turn into white.
Sir, you told that
Dibyendu
created the universe, right? So, how is it possible that so much things means from absolutely nothing means?
So much things?
From absolutely nothing
means. Rajesh would take that question. This is the standard question. So, essentially, to my understanding, I will not venture to guess what was there before the Big Bang. If you ask this question of most people who are cosmologists, will not also venture to give you an answer if you ask what was there before the Big Bang. It is sort of a singularity where you know, our ideas of physics break down. The understanding is that there was enough energy somehow in whatever form, which eventually gave rise to this expression from where matter, as I explained, materialized. What was there before the Big Bang, where it came from, I don't think anybody has an idea. Rajesh, do you have an idea? When you do not know the right answer, pass the buck.
What exactly do we mean by that universe? Is everything around us or
everything that exists in space-time? Rapidly in the first period, yes, in the question period.
Before Big Bang, as you mentioned.
I have not mentioned anything before the Big Bang. The story starts at Big Bang.
Not exactly before Big Bang, but you can say that at the beginning phase of Big Bang, everything was
at least equal to zero. Let's just be very, very honest about this.
Okay, explicitly at t equals to 0, everything was concentrated, the energy at a point, and then started expanding. So as the universe expands, the energy is also expanding outerwards, but the entropy is hence increasing as well. So it's a one-directional process. There is no turning back, right?
There is this other theory that the universe goes to cycles, which is sort of been now shelved. But yes, so I think the current theory is that the universe will more or less keep on expanding forever. Is that right, Rajesh?
Yeah. But entropy is still conserved. It's a reversible process. So entropy is not nothing new.
As far as I know, our solar system was formed from a planetary disk or a protoplanetary disk, and it was in motion. And ultimately, at the center, some of the gases collapsed due to gravity and formed the sun. And the planets also condensed around the sun, which was formed.
So what happens is once the sun is formed, it pulls together material around it, and due to some environmental considerations, it sort of gets considered on disks. And the disk itself has instabilities out of which planets can form. And you see some of that impact, that is you can see such things, I believe, in some other planets. For example, I think in Venus or some other Saturn, where you see in the rings this sort of planetary signals. You see these small little objects forming out of the disk. Coalescing together, and actually have observations of that process.
Sir, then why do some planets exhibit prograde motion and why do some exhibit retrograde motion?
It's a good question. I don't know the answer to that
question.
I think it would possibly depend on the angular momentum of the initial clump of matter from which it formed, but why would some have a different angular momentum? I would not know unless there is a collision between different planets, which can then redistribute the angle and change the speed.
But initially, they were all rotating in a particular direction at the protoplanetary disk.
The protoplanetary disk, one would imagine, is rotating in the same direction. So anything that forms there would form, as you said, with the same direction of speed. The only way I can think of to change that is collisions between two planets or with something else.
Do you have anything else to add to that? Collisions, other collisions, I can't
think of. That is the source of the different rotation speeds. Even the Earth was slowed down by a collision. So.
That
is.
There's no internal mechanism that will do that. Pure simple as that.
Thanks. Sir, yes. As you told that Voyager is now carrying some pictures of humanity, the existence of humanity, does New Horizon also have the same fate?
Same fate as we go out of the...
What is the future of New Horizon?
I don't know. What will eventually happen to New Horizon? Voyager was envisioned as a mission that will actually take it out of the heliosphere. It was supposed to study the heliosheath, which is a sort of layer which is at the boundary between the heliosphere. The heliosphere is sort of the solar wind. The wind from the sun is expanding outwards, where that collides with the interstellar medium. So the medium that exists outside the solar system is supposed to be shock waves and other interesting physics going on there. Magnetic discontinuities, the magnetic field of the sun reconnecting with the magnetic field in the interstellar medium. So it is supposed to study all this. So it is supposed to go to the heliosphere. New Horizons, I do not know whether the orbit is designed to take it out of the solar system.
It is up to the Oort cloud, the comet cloud.
I have no idea. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful talk. I need to speak for himself. I now request Professor Rajesh Nayak to deliver his speech.
Resulted in the Nobel Prize in physics. So this is one of the greatest challenges in sciences, is looking at Einstein's theory of generativity and trying to directly detect astrophysical gravitational waves. And I hope that Rajesh and the LIGO team eventually does manage to do that. And if that happens, I believe that we will have perhaps at least a Nobel citation.
The saying that don't count your chicken before you lay. So
there is also something called hope.
Yeah. So another interesting title would have been to thought provoking would have been Einstein right, okay, or Einstein wrong. But I decided that to call that. We are beginning to listen universe. This is in the sense that, you know, sound doesn't come out without any media. This is a separate listening. It is listening to gravitational waves. So LIGO, which is an instrument, will I briefly mention on the way how it works and so on. So it has begin to work. That means gravitational wave detection is now possible. If nature allows us. So that is an interesting phase. So that is why we say now we are begin to listen universe. Okay, let's see what is this. I would say that I would want to start with a small tutorial. Okay, you might be surprised why this talk should be starting with a tutorial. I'll give you a data and you have to figure out what is the source. Okay, and I will ask more questions. You can see that how well you can model a system based on the given signal. So let's say you can figure this out. I hope not. Okay? Nothing. This signal you can't figure it out. It is something. Let me give the proper signal. Yeah. Hands are already off. The question is, what is the age of the person who is playing this guitar when he was playing? Okay. Now, once you know that, you could also ask more questions. Like, what is his mass? Or what is his weight when he was playing this? Also ask what is his girlfriend's name or wife. You can keep doing it. Is astrophysics is nowhere different from this. Okay, so one is you find that many of you have heard this. That means you have already know the signal which I am presenting. Now if I have given you something which I have taken completely out of where you have no clue, some piece of signal I have played it, then you could not have figured it out. That means you already have the model of the waveform or signal which I am presenting to you, and you are quickly able to figure it out. So this is an enormous gift given to human being to process sound. It's actually a matter of survival that you find that you need to figure out who is based on the sound processing. Okay, so for example, how precisely you can figure out. Like for example, you would, no matter how noisy system is, noise is one of the problem in every signal. For example, noise sound. So this is what you would get if your instrument is not tuned to anything. You just get white noise. Now sometimes there may be weak signal. If radio station is very sound, you will listen all the music. Otherwise, you will just listen noise. So this can happen. But you see, you have a huge room, lot of people talking, big party is going on. Somebody calls your name, you will immediately identify it. Okay, so that is a special technique. You are able to identify your name. For example, everybody identifies their mother's voice. Okay, not only just voice, based on how it is said, based on various models, you are able to manipulate what is a mood. Okay, whether your mother is angry with you or happy with you, and whether to appear or not to appear. So you figure out. This is just a matter of survival. So this is exactly what is being done in the case of gravitational wave astronomy. You have a model of signal. It is not learned day-to-day basis or anything like that. It is based on some proper theory. You have Einstein's theory which predicts how masses should move and so on. And based on that theory, you can predict signal. And with that, you detect. Either it does not matter how much noise you have. Okay, let's quickly go over this, what is called space, time, and geometry. This gentleman, nearly 100 years back, it's actually 100 years, centennial year of general theory of relativity. According to his theory, space time can be deformed or bent. Okay, but unfortunately, the deformation is very small. That means it is much harder, you know, like rules, very rigid rules you can bend very easily. But space time is much harder. It's not as easy to bend them you like. So, for example, any presence of matter could deform space. But the deformation is very small. For example, sun, which has a 10 to the power 30 kgs, can make a very tiny deflection in the space-time. So the effect is very small, it is incredibly small. You can do more things, what you call the gravitational waves. Okay, now when you have a moving object, now that will produce these fluctuations which are propagating at the speed of light. So that is basically which is coming from the theory. I don't want to go into all the details, but you can just simply say that if you have a static object which is deforming the space, if the objects are moving, then it is going to produce ripples or deformation which propagates as a waves in your space-time. So those are called gravitational waves. They were immediately predicted by Einstein in 1916. After his theory, okay, the theory immediately, linear scale immediately says there should be gravitational waves. So, okay, he predicted and all that thing, but unfortunately, effects are very, very small. Now, for example, if you tie charge to a thread and rotate it like this, okay, so that should emit electromagnetic radiation. So, it's a simple theory which is coming from electromagnetic theory, that is what happens to all atoms. There are no slingshots, there are just you have two charges going around each other and they can emit electromagnetic radiation. Very same should happen for gravitational waves because in principle, other than complexity of theory, they are very similar. So if you have a mass tied to a rope and rotate, it should emit gravitational waves. Okay, so you can all generate gravitational waves when you move, jump, up and down and all that. Unfortunately, the signal is very, very weak. So like 1 meter, this thing you use and 1000 kg you use, the amplitude you produce is of the order of 10 to the power minus 34. Okay, so you see that number in itself does not make sense. So you cannot have Hertz-like experiment. You cannot have some aliens sitting there and sending signals. This is the only reference to LISA I have is based on this. LISA is a space mission. Do we have a pointer? So this guy is sending signals, and you can see it's modulated. What he says is that it is written in some different language. Some of you might know that what the language is. Some of you may not know about this language. But when you want aliens want to communicate with you with gravitational waves, they can in fact do. An important thing is when you want to communicate, language is not really valuable. Language is important when you only want to confuse. So otherwise, language is not really important. So you could use. Okay, all the theory is fine. You could sit on and work it out and think together, and you can, do they really exist? That is a question you would like to ask. So that experimentally you should be able to find out. So these two gentlemen, 1971, they found a system which is called binary pulsar. So this pulsar essentially means you have heard this death of stars and so on. So supernova can leave an object which is roughly size of 10 kilometers, and it can hold the mass of about 1 to 2 solar mass. So you have an object which is barely twice the size of our here to that road, there up there or from here to Kalyani, and can hold 10 solar masses, not 10 solar masses, about 2 solar masses. And two of such objects which are going around, okay, their orbital period is of the order of 7 hours. You see that, that is an amazing relativistic system. So they observed this system for a couple of years, and they realized that this could be an interesting test for general theory of relativity, where there are dense objects which are going at a very high speed. So what did they do? They tried to fit it with an emission of gravitational waves. So you can have system which does not, let's say theory do not have gravitational waves at all. That is like a Newtonian theory. Then your system should not be changing at all. Okay, so here what happens? You have two objects going around each other. Okay, so let's say they are emitting gravitational waves. When they emit gravitational waves, they lose energy, and then they come closer. And they come closer, they move faster, and they emit gravitational wave faster. So this is exactly the phenomena which was worrying physicists beginning of last century, where how atoms were stable. Because if electron has to go around proton, it has to emit radiation because the system is unstable. Accelerated charge should emit radiation and it should fall. Quantum mechanics stopped but that process, and you have whole quantum theory of atoms and so on. But here that does not happen. Quantum effect has no quantum mechanics has no effect. So gravity, when two stars are going around each other, they emit radiation and it's runaway process. It spirals into each other and then hits. Okay, so that is the system. So what they observe is that orbital frequency as a function of time, and they found it changes because of the emission of gravitational waves. So that fits very nicely with Einstein's theory. Theory and the experiment completely matches. So this was an amazing matching with the theory, and they were awarded Nobel Prize for this discovery. Okay, so what is the connection with sound? Now the connection with sound comes from the fact that they are designing their gravitational wave detectors on Earth. I will come back to them after next slide or later.
So what happens? They have a sensitivity, frequency dependent phenomena, because you have seen that they are going around, their frequency keeps on increasing. So the ground-based detector have a sensitivity from 40 hertz to 1 kilohertz or more, 2 kilohertz on that range, or 10 hertz to a few kilohertz. So this is the audible frequency. So you can, gravitational wave signals, you can hear. If you feed it to the speakers, you would hear what is saying. So there's a very interesting science you can do now. Not by going to big computers. By going to this site, what is called blackholeantlers.org. So what they have done is, they have converted these waveforms, which is numerically simulated based on the two black holes going around each other, how they would emit gravitational radiation. Those waves of form have been converted into sound, and they were put in the web page. And you can be now a black hole hunter. So you can have some, there are some mixed with noise, some mixed, some signal with noise, some without noise, and all that thing. Now the question is whether you can pick up the signal because of gravitational waves or not. All you need is an internet and a earphone. Without earphone, you will find it extremely difficult. So here is what really happens when two black holes go around each other and that object will be enough. So in the initial phase, they are just going around each other, their frequency keeps on increasing because of this runaway process. And then when they come close, more complicated things happen. People do not really know how to manage this based on Einstein's theory. Is extremely non-linear and cannot handle this. And then the last phase, they all merge into a single object. Okay, you would say that, okay, now you need a black holes. We are talking about black holes are more common than you think they are in the universe. Okay, so if you are able to figure if this has happened, then you should be able to see them with a ground-based detector. Now let me see that the waveform. In the real form, it looks like this. It is frequencies keep on increasing. This is buried in the noise. Let me play some of this. This is one signal. Okay, some two black holes with a dissimilar mass. Now, then the another system. Okay, so you see that the parameters, the waveform generated is based on the masses of black hole and so on. Now you see, I played two, you can clearly distinguish them. Okay, so you have many such reasons them and again, and then you probably are able to do a very good gravitational wave detection. This is a high noise, and there is a signal buried. Okay, this is a high signal to noise just to ensure that you can make a full detection. Now it could be symphony or it could be cacophony in the universe. You can have many of these going and producing a lot of gravitational waves. There are, let me go through quickly over this, what are the sources. Supernovae, this is like a big bang. You know, it's not like a big bang which has happened in the beginning of the universe. This is the most energetic this thing. But the problem with the supernovae is that you are not able to model the signal. It is a dissimilar, it's like an explosion. You have seen that to identify this signal from the noise, you need to know them. Okay, I have already said that only if you know the waveform, then only you can figure them from the noise. No matter if you have a huge audience, some lot of noise going on, if somebody calls your name, you will definitely listen to it. That is because you know that waveform. If some X calling Y, no matter how loudly he is calling, you may simply ignore it, you know, because you are just not paying attention. So this would certainly happen in the case of gravitational waves. The most interesting source are two compact objects going around each other, because they can be well modeled based on Einstein's theory and based on numerical theory of relativity. So they are the most promising sources. Two black holes going around, spinning object. A single star, neutron stars, very compact object rotating about its own axis can generate a good amount of gravitational. So those also can be seen.
Another interesting source is from the Big Bang. If you have some bang happened in the beginning of universe, there must have been masses moving at a very high speed. So they should have produced some gravitational waves. Though they would have dilated now, but you would still have some signal there. Then you might be able to detect them too. These are some of the sources. Detection. Let me quickly go over this detection. The problem with the detection, what are the effects of gravitational waves? Gravitational wave is essentially space-time wave. That means when you are measuring distance between the two points, it would change as a function of time when wave is passing through. So you have to now measure carefully distance between the two points and keep it as a function of time. If wave is propagating, you will see the distance. The strain delta L by L is of the order of 10 to the power minus 23. Okay, so that is what is the problem. So it was predicted by Einstein 100 years back. We have not directly detected it. That is because if you keep a 1 meter stick, okay, then if a wave goes through, astrophysical wave goes through it, the change delta L produces 10 to the power minus 3, minus 23 meters. That is an absurd number, right? Size of a nucleus or nuclear matter is about 10 to the power minus 18. So that is why it is not possible. But what is people do? People do is what is known as a technique known as a laser interferometer. Now you increase L. Instead of 1 meter, you use 1 kilometer. You use 10 kilometers. Then you are, this reaches to 10 to the power minus 1 kilometer is 20, 10 to the power minus 20, and then use more power lasers, and there are a lot of theory about it and so on. Extremely complicated, but it turns out that you can do it, provided you have very carefully built a laser interferometer. Presently, there are 3-4 working, 2 in US, USA called LIGO, laser interferometer and gravitational wave observatory. They are 4 kilometer long. Okay, so you have a Michelson interferometer where you have a central station, all the way goes 4 kilometer, and then you have this thing. There are other in Europe and so on. So this is basically how it works. You have a laser, it splits into two beams. You know, some of you might know what is a Michelson interferometer. So this goes all the way. This length is about 4 kilometer, and this length is about 4 kilometer. So that is the size of a detector you have. Whole thing is built inside the vacuum, and then you operate this and measure the tiny differences which is happening. So this instrument is up and running for last 10 days, detecting, taking the data which may detect the gravitational waves. Okay, so I will leave that at this stage. It is not about giving you whole picture, just to give a quick overview. So this kind of a detectors have been working and they are functioning. Hopefully they will make some detection and very soon. Of course, that is fine. But there is one of the major problem in these detectors. They are not able to see from where it is coming. It is unlike other telescope where you can point it at an object. They collect signal from all over. It is like an antenna. Antenna does not have a directionality, so it just picks up. If some event happens, you don't know where it is. It is just triggered here. So if you want to figure out where exactly source is coming, it's like a sound. Again, like a sound. So if you don't know, if you like, we are able to make sound detection from where it is coming because of 2 ears. Okay, 2 ears and complex brain is doing some calculation and telling you where the sound is coming. So same thing we could do with the gravitational wave. You could have, now that we have nothing to do with the ears and so on, we could have 2, 3, 4 ears as many you want and then collect signal from that. So that is what is called a network of detector. It's very important to have this network of detector. Based on the time delay of arrival of signal, you can figure out where it is coming from. So that is where astronomy of gravitational wave is playing role. For that, what is important is how far you are building. So in US, they are building at 2 extreme ends of US. So that means one at the Louisiana, and the US is like a box, and you have at the diagonal end, you have one in the Louisiana and one in the Washington state. So they are building, it's about 13 millisecond time travel time, something like that. So it would be better if you have at the other place in the globe. There is one in Europe near Rome or Italy or Pisa where you have that covers three detector. So that makes it a very good detector and so on. So but they found that dumb people started calculating. Okay, we are good with calculating. You know, you put in all theory. It's harder to build this instrument, easier to do all these calculations. So you find out, you figure out where is the best position if you want to put one more detector. It turns out that that is somewhere in the Indian Ocean. Okay, you can't have detector needed in the ocean. So you have to find the nearest land. So that has happened to be India. So it would be a good place to have an Indian detector in India. Currently, this is a proposal for LIGO India. One of the copy of LIGO detector will be made built on Indian soil. It's a very good opportunity for Indians to get involved in this major project. It's an extremely sophisticated instrument which runs 4 kilometer by 4 kilometer. And this gives a considerable leverage in doing science. So this is a basic baseline, what you call, why we should have it in India and so on. So this is a basic science case. If you don't have Indian detector, you will be able to spot them where in the sky is the detector with these error. For example, smaller circle here means lesser error. Larger circle means more error. That means some of the places you are not able to figure out very well where exactly the source is in the sky. But if you have this dark red crosses, if signal is there, you will not be able to see it at all. Detector is simply blind in that direction. So that is why if you have this India, all the blind spots are gone and all the resolutions have become better. And also, you have the third detector, it will also help you to improve the detection statistics and come up with a much better this thing, whether you have really detected the signal or not. So in simple ways, if you have that detector, there is a proposal put now in front of the Prime Minister for approval. If that detector comes, if it is approved, detector should be on Indian soil by 2022 or something like that. Okay, so in short, we are ready to listen. Okay, it's all the universe has to oblige us with some source. Okay, thank you. Do you have any question?
Thank you, sir, for such a brilliant talk. Now I'll move on to the audience if you want to ask any questions.
Okay, everybody is hungry, it's a good choice.
I have a question, Rajesh, for your stupid question.
Yeah.
So, when you have a detector in terms of a large length, right, or whatever, that is what LIGO is eventually, right?
Yeah.
So, the way we are actually measuring this is an alteration in length. This is really happening because space itself is being altered. In the sense, the space is either decreasing or increasing due to the passage of the wave itself, right?
Yeah.
So if you had a scale which had a certain mass which is behaving similar to the detector, you would not be able to make a detection if the scale would behave exactly similar to the original detector itself. Is that right?
No. Scale, end of the scale would have changed.
But if it's changing similarly to the detector itself,
Everything would change. Everything would change. The idea here is that I have not really gone into compensating. This is the 3 point is which is important. It's a relative distance measurement.
Right.
And you cannot make it with 1 point. So now we are measuring distance between 1, 2, and 3 points. So now the relative displacement of these 2 arms which you count. Then you can then calculate based on how this theory, what it predicts, you can see, and that is all. So the scale itself will not give you, because if you have this, you have to measure with respect to something. That means if this is itself is going, it is oscillating and it keeps motion. So you have to include time somehow. The time, incorporation of time is done through light. Light is have to, all relativistic measurement have to incorporate.
So the electromagnetic part comes in.
Yeah. It's basically measuring time. You send a light beam and then get back and keep on measuring that as your measure length measurement. And then you use that.
Okay.
So recently in an article that there is some observation going on that the planets rotating around itself creates a twist in the space-time. So does that also create a gravitational wave?
So let's say that planets. See, the point of gravitational wave is two things. One is velocity have to be very close to velocity of light. Okay. Two, mass have to be very large. So that means if you have for example, sun, you shrink it to make sun as a neutron star. Let's say one solar mass built into 10 kilometer size, and let's say it is rotating with the speed once 1 millisecond. It takes one round in 1 millisecond. Okay, and it has a small mountain on it. Okay, then it will be able to emit the gravitational radiation with amplitude 10 to the power minus 25. Okay, so that H will be 10 to the power minus 25. Now you want to bring that to planet. Planets will have a mass of 10 to the power minus 24, plus 24. Okay, the solar mass is 10 to the power 30. So you have 10 to the power minus 6. So you add that minus 6 there. So 31. Okay, speed is much less. Planets going 27, whatever. You can speed them. That is not an issue. You can bombard with something and speed them. Speed is not probably a problem. So the amplitude is very small.
Sir, if the amplitude is so much small, sir, why do we have so many sources of noise? What is this noise?
Noise is not coming from the amplitude. What happens is that you see that there is a detector, let's say this is a detector, you have kept on Earth. I have one point here and I am less 4 kilometers. Okay, this is on Earth. Earth is not a very quiet thing. Earth is going to vibrate. Okay, there are seismic noise which is coming. Okay, then you have a redox system which is not perfect. Then you have all noises are associated with the instrument. Laser you have, it is not perfect. Okay, so all these leads to noise. So if you are measuring, like for example in the lab, simple Michelson interferometer, you are measuring delta L by L of order of 10 to the power minus 8 and so on. Okay, but here you are talking about 10 to the power minus 23. So for example, if a bus is passing through, let's say a train, bus is even car, near one of the detector, the simply vibration of ground would be recorded. Okay, so you have everything which oscillates producing the gravitational, not gravitational wave, deformation at 4 kilometer range. You are taking a rod which is 4 kilometer long, and then you are saying what all it can oscillate. For example, passing cloud, if cloud suddenly changes, this detector can see. Because relative gravity between two endpoints at 4 kilometers has changed as a function of time. That is a noise. We don't want to listen to clouds. We want to listen which is coming from outside. So there are many, many noises. Noises is a very important thing to understand is noises. This detector was started in mid-90s, early 90s. So it took nearly 20 years to reach the sensitivity where you can measure. Because this noise has to be suppressed. You have to move on to eliminate. Seismic noise is a major problem. Other side, what is known as a photon counting noise. It means every time you count a photon, you make an error of that same order. That is called photon counting mass. That contributes. So these two, there are many other bonds because system is in the some finite temperature, so that is going to make an oscillation. So these are all various noises which are possible.
So the noise is in the air of the instrument rather than in the variations in the field.
Noises?
So the lack of sensitivity of the instrument rather than yes. Problems with the field.
Yeah. Field is fixed. 10 to the power minus 23, 10 to the power minus 22. You your instrument have to reach to that level of measurement of delta L by L. So that nonsense will keep coming and you have to suppress them and increase them. For example, simple thing is, you will be completely baffled if I give you the number. Kind of a laser which is fired at this end, its power is 200 watts. Okay, 200 watts of continuous power is pumped into this. There are no lasers which can do it. There are only three lasers which are used in LIGO only can do that. Okay, there are no such laser exist elsewhere. This is a continuous laser, not pulse laser which can go very high. Now, this capacity, this two mirrors, okay, these are about 30 centimeter mirror, each weighs about 40 kgs. The power of light which is stored in that cavity corresponds to 1 megawatt. Okay, there is a 1 megawatt power stored between those two mirrors. So it is so stiff that nothing other than gravitational wave would like to compress, we want it to compress. But unfortunately, many things other which are also compressing this cavity which is giving rise to mass. It is an amazing piece of equipment. Technological wonders.
Sir, you said that to detect the waves from noise, we first have to know the waves.
Yeah.
So, how do we know the waves?
Yeah, how do we know the waves?